dry bones come alive. Wind of the Holy Spirit, wind of the Holy Ghost, wind of the Holy Spirit, breathe upon us right now. 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 Wind of the Holy Spirit, breathe upon us right now. Oh, we thank you for the wind. We thank you for the wind. Shaka la brada da ba sata la brado ko sata la baba. Shaba baba raba sala brada kazala brado ko zaba baba baba she. Sheke la brada kazala brada kashata la raba baba baba se. Shata la brada kasata la bako sata da ba sade. Release it.
Sheke de barabote. Hey, 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 ka pa 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 ke. And not just are they coming alive, but that verse goes on to say they rose, they ascended, they stood up, a great and mighty army. Lord, on this Resurrection Sunday, we decree and we declare that this Passover resurrection season, open the eyes of our spirit, open our spirit, man, to not just the death, not just the burial, not just the resurrection, but we rule and we reign and we are ascended in life in Christ Jesus. Jesus led captivity captive and he gave gifts unto men. And those gifts are the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, the teachers, that he is oraba se probateya, oterianda de propoketeya, ete probosete. And there is an 11th hour anointing where those people and those giftings and governments and graces and governances and guidances in this season and in this time, I decree and I declare that from this year, this Passover resurrection season, not do we just have a revelation of the Passover and the resurrection, but we have a revelation that he was ascended and we have ascended and rule and reign with him. We rule and reign in life in Christ Jesus. So I decree, dry bones come alive, dry gifts come alive, and right now is a prophetic act. I just feel to do this. We take off our old grave clothes. We receive the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Oh, strengthen the weak hands, strengthen the feeble knees. I say hands, hands that have been hung down, lift them up without wrath and without doubting. Voices that have been silenced and been stilled, but a resurrection roar in your mouth this day. And the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the blood of Jesus decrees and declares, it is open season. It is open season and it is hunting season. Oh, in the realm of the spirit. And there is coming new prey, new treasures, and new spoils out of the darkness in this Passover and resurrection and ascension weekend.
Father, we thank you and we call it done. We call it done in the realm of the spirit. We call it done. We call it done. We call it done. We call it done. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. We call it done. In the name of Jesus.
my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my
us to look at 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 12. I've just come back this morning from Harvest Point down in Bull Desert. We had an amazing time in the presence of the Lord. And we were drunk in the spirit. I thank God there was somebody else driving. Pastor Mark Ironside had to be carried out. People were out. We had people who had to get motels, couldn't get home. They had driven all the way. There was such an outpouring of God's Spirit, such an outpouring of God's power and miracles and healings. People with back issues and all sorts of problems healed in that meetings, in those meetings over the last 2 days. And yesterday afternoon, I was in Brisbane at another tent meeting. So preached 2 meetings yesterday, so my voice is a little bit hoarse. So hopefully I'm going to be a little bit cool, calm, and collected this morning so I can get through this message if the Holy Spirit allows. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12, the Bible says, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life, to which you are also called, and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. 2 Timothy chapter 4, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 to 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 to 8. It says, for I'm already been poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but to all, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Father, we thank you that those of us who have been fighting the good fight of faith, that we will be able to say it is finished, just like you did on the cross. Speak to us this morning. Minister to us this morning. In Jesus' mighty name. Somebody say amen. Now, one thing we need to understand about Jesus is that Jesus fought the good fight of faith. Whenever each and every, and this is for every saint and every believer in this place, we have all been called by God to fight the good fight of faith. Now, when you look at Jesus's ministry, and let me just say this, God wants us to finish and to finish well. He's not a God of abandoned projects. Whatever he begins, he always completes. That's why the Bible says, he who began a good work in you will be able to what? To bring it to completion. He is faithful. He will be able to bring it to completion. So in life, you will find yourself many times needing to fight the good fight of faith. Many believers who don't finish well because they have not learned how to fight the good fight of faith. Jesus was fighting the good fight of faith. From the time he was born, he was continuously fighting that good fight. The Bible says that he went and he got his disciples, his 12 disciples. And when he got his 12 disciples, the Bible says that some of them, and let me just say this, not all of them were perfect. As a matter of fact, none of them was perfect. And sometimes one of the reasons why God wants us to fight the good fight of faith is because we have been called by God to partner with imperfect people. Nobody finishes by themselves. Not even Jesus. He carried the cross, and the Bible says that he fell towards the end. And they had to pull somebody out of the crowd to help him carry the cross the rest of the way. And the reason why they did that was because the Lord wanted to set it in stone that nobody can finish by themselves. Each and every one of us needs somebody else. We need to partner with other people in order to finish well. Even Christ himself had to finish well. The Bible says he began to stumble, and they had to call this man Simon. They said, you got to carry the cross the rest of the way. And so we understand that if we're going to finish the assignment that God has given us, and let me just say this, everyone has an assignment. Everyone has got a race that they're running. Some of us, we are running a 100-meter dash. Some of us, we are doing marathons. Some of us, we've been called to walk. Some of us, we've been called to fly. Amen. But we are all moving in a general direction where there's going to be a finish line and a trophy at the end of it. We've all been called to run a race. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall walk. Some of us have been called to walk. The Bible tells us, and it talks about those who will run and not be weary. Some of us, we've been called to run. Some of us, when you look, they've got big ministries. Some have walkers, have smaller ministries. Some have got bigger assignments. Some have got smaller assignments. But whether you're walking, running, or flying, we are all heading towards a finishing line. Jesus picked this imperfect man. And you've got to understand, God will partner you with imperfect people. And we have to understand that the fight that we are fighting in this life has to be a good fight of faith. It's got to be a good fight of faith. Because when you partner with imperfect people, you will have a reason to quit. I'm preaching good right now. It's quiet in this Baptist church. Amen. How many of you know that whenever you partner with imperfect people, you will get to a place where you struggle to finish your race? The Bible says that he partnered with Peter. Peter, you never know where he was from time to time. One moment he says, who do men say that I am? And he says, some say you are you, some say you're this, that, and the other. And then Peter stands up and he says, all of a sudden he gets a revelation. And he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, good on you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you. On that same chapter, a few verses later, Jesus stands up and he says, I'm going to go to the cross and die. And Peter stands up and says, over my dead body. Jesus looks at him and says, get thee behind me, Satan. Have you ever had friends you don't know from day to day whether it is the Holy Ghost or it's Satan? Come on, somebody. Amen. Have you ever had to partner with people you don't know from day to day who you're dealing with, whether it's Jekyll or Hyde? And yet you can't cut them off because God has partnered you with them to take you to that till the end of the finishing line. Somebody say, fight the good fight of faith. Jesus connected with imperfect men. The Bible tells us about Thomas, doubting Thomas. He doubted everything. Sometimes you may partner with people who doubt everything about you. They will doubt your call. They will doubt your ministry. They will doubt your assignment. Whatever you do, they will always sow doubt into it. I don't know if we can do this. Let's go and win the Lord. Now, I don't know. You will always find yourself partnering with people that may not believe in what God has called you to do. How many of you know Jesus was partnered with people that didn't believe in him? Even when he had been used by God and God had revealed himself over his life, he still partnered with people that did not believe in him and did not believe in what assignment God had given him. Some began well with him. They believed him. But when offense came in, they didn't believe in him. And sometimes you may partner with people who may be offended with you. Don't stop fighting and lose the good fight of faith just because of offense. Bible tells us about John the Baptist. John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John the Baptist was called by God. He was born. He was raised. He was sent to earth with an assignment to prepare you the way of the Lord. That was his assignment. His job was to make way for Christ. And when Jesus was 30 years old, he came to John's baptism. John had already been baptizing for years and years. He had a reputation around Jerusalem. And Jesus comes to John. And when he comes to John, John sees him. And he says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He announces Jesus to his disciples and those who are around him. And when Jesus stands in front of him, he says, I'm not worthy to baptize you. You baptize me. And Jesus says, allow it to be so for now so that we can fulfill all righteousness. And the Bible tells us immediately he says that he baptizes Jesus. That Jesus comes out of the water. The heavens are open. The Father speaks from heaven verbally. How many have ever had the audible voice of God? Not many. Amen. Not many people have had that opportunity to hear the audible. Those people who are there had the audible voice of God. The Holy Spirit came upon Jesus like a dove, visible. They saw, John the Baptist saw, and those who recorded it, they saw the Holy Spirit descending upon him like a dove. Yet when the ministry of John the Baptist began to go down and the ministry of Jesus began to go up and John was arrested, offense came into his heart and he began to question whether Jesus was the one or should we wait for another. You can partner and connect with people who believe you one moment, announce you one moment, but the next moment they do not even know if you are even called by God. You've got to understand that we are all in a race. And we are fighting the good fight of faith. Jesus said, go tell John the Baptist when these messengers came to him. Go tell John what you have seen, what you have heard. The gospel is preached. The blind see, the lame walk, the deaf hear. And go tell him, blessed is he who is not offended in me. In this good fight of faith, sometimes your rising may be the falling of others, and they may hate you when on their way down. Many people have walked away from serving God when they realize that this fight that they're in, that there can be conflicts that comes along. But God is speaking to us this morning. And he's saying to us, I want you to continue to fight the good fight of faith. Because the next morning when you get up and you get dressed and you have a shower and you get back in the work and you continue to serve God, you are fighting the good fight of faith. Because in this life you'll be surrounded with everything that tries to get you to quit. Everything that tries to get you to stop. You will be surrounded with opposition that will try to hinder you. That's what happened with Jesus. Jesus was surrounded with opposition. His first sermon that he preached, the Bible says he opened the scriptures, opened the scroll, and he began to read this particular scroll. He started saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. And he begins to talk about what he was anointed to do. Then the Bible says after he finished, he closed the scroll and he said, today the scripture has been fulfilled in your ears. Let me tell you, they were not happy with this sermon. They grabbed him. They were going to throw him off of the mountain. Come on, somebody. Can you imagine your first sermon that you're preaching and now they want to throw you off of a cliff? Come on, somebody. We've been better than that. Amen. How many of you, we've had a better deal than that? You talk about people that hate you, that don't like you. They grabbed him. They took him at the edge of a cliff, about to chuck him. But God was not through with him. He turned around and he walked through them and he went on his way. Come on, somebody. It doesn't matter who doesn't like you, who doesn't appreciate you, who doesn't give you a high five, a pat on the back. You keep on preaching. You keep on serving the Lord. If your first time doesn't work, you preach again and you preach again. You keep fighting the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, don't give up, don't give in. Some of us, we've already thrown the fight. We've already given up the fight. Jesus didn't give up the fight. Even when they didn't like his sermon, they didn't like what he was preaching, he kept on keeping on. Don't worry about the response of the people. Don't worry if they receive it or don't receive it. You keep on keeping on. Stay in the fight. I came to help somebody in this place stay in the fight. Amen. I say stay in the fight. Hallelujah. Black and blue, but stay in the fight. Punched out, stay in the fight. Room spinning, but stay in the fight. I'm helping somebody in this place that is getting ready to quit. I said, stay in the fight. Amen. Hallelujah. There's so many people who put their hand to the plow, but stuff happens and they walk away from God. Why did you walk? Somebody said this. Somebody talked bad about me. Somebody posted something on Facebook on me. I'm mad. I'm upset. I'm leaving the church. Let me just say this. We have thrown the fight. God is looking for those who will stay in the fight and say, if God called me to do this, I'm going to keep doing it. Even if they receive it or don't receive it, I'm going to stay in the fight. I came to tell somebody, stay in the fight. If we are going to say it is finished and have a resurrection, we have to stay in the fight. It's not easy. And sometimes we've been bashed up. Amen. Sometimes life and ministry and serving God can punch us out. We can be in a place where we've got a few bumps on the head, but keep on keeping on. I came to tell somebody, keep on keeping on. Are you breathing? I said, keep on keeping on. I said, keep on keeping on. I said, keep on keeping on. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. And sometimes you may need to encourage yourself in the Lord. You get up in the morning, you get dressed. I don't feel like going, but you just got to speak to yourself. No, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to stay in the race. I'm not stopping. I may feel like I've got a stitch. You know how when you do a marathon, I'm not a runner, praise God. But when I used to, you don't drink water and run. Sometimes you get a stitch. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It's not easy when you're running with a stitch. And sometimes that's what happens. You stop and you have a drink and you begin continuing the race and you are running with a limp, but keep on keeping on. Yeah. Jesus, what he did on the cross is that he taught us how to keep on fighting and stay in the fight, the good fight of faith. Doesn't matter what happens, keep on keeping on. Keep on keeping on. Keep on keeping on. Keep on pressing in. Keep on running the race that is set before you. People may leave you, people may reject you, people may turn on you, but you keep on keeping on. Hallelujah. The Bible says he was partnered with somebody that was going to betray him. And what's more painful is that he knew it. It's one thing to be partnered with a betrayer and not knowing. And it's another thing to be partnered with somebody that will betray you and you know it and you still have to walk in love. How many of you know that walk of love towards somebody that is already wired to betray you? That is called fighting the good fight of faith. How are you doing? I'm fighting. Come on, somebody. It's a good fight. Come on, somebody. And I like it because it says good fight of faith, because there's dirty fighting. And we believers are good at dirty fighting. If you do unto me, you know what they believe? Do unto others before they do unto you. Amen. Do one unto others before they do. So if they say something, I must say something back about them. If they attack me, I will attack them. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That is called fighting, but it's not a good fight of faith. It's a bad one. That's the kind of fight that causes you to finish last in this kingdom. Sometimes you gotta turn the other cheek. Somebody say, turn the other cheek. When somebody slaps you, Jesus says, present the other cheek for them to slap also. That's called the good fight of faith. They say, are you still friends with them? Don't you remember what they did for you to you yesterday? Yes, I remember, but I'm turning the other cheek. I'm still walking in relationship with them. Come on, somebody. I said, come on, somebody. Council culture is not kingdom culture. We don't keep people out of our lives just because they messed up one time. Come on, somebody. People may come to you and say, why are you still in relationship with that person? Don't you remember what they did to you? Don't you remember how they betrayed you? You know what I've done? I've turned the other cheek. I know, but I'm still going to keep walking with them because I'm in a fight. I'm in a fight. Every day I know I have to smile. I have to keep loving them. I have to keep on appreciating them. I need to keep on investing in their lives. I need to keep on putting something in and do, because my ministry is discipleship included. I have to keep on pouring into them, even when they are stealing from my pocket, even when they are trying to come on somebody. He kept on with Judas. Judas was a thief. And you may be partnered with people that take from you instead of making investments. They deplete you. Have you ever been with somebody that whenever you're with them, they deplete you? There's a thieving spirit on them. There's a thieving grace that is on them. And they don't come to release anything. You spend time with them and something is leaving your life. That's what Judas was. The Bible says he was a thief. Everything he said because he was a what? A thief. And sometimes we will be partnered with people that are negative and they're constantly making withdrawals and never making deposits in our lives. But every stumbling block is going to be a stepping stone. Hallelujah. Because the rock or the stone that the builders rejected is going to become the chief cornerstone. All things work together for good. It's not a mistake who God partnered Jesus with. It wasn't a mistake that Peter, who had a temper issue, was partnered with Jesus. It's not a mistake that some of the Bonaggi, sons of thunder, who preferred to call judgment and fire and destroy cities because they never understood the heart of Jesus. It is not a mistake that these people were partnered with Jesus. Now, most of us, we may want to disconnect ourselves from these people because we feel that life is going to be better without them. But let me just say this. The worst of the worst are the most important that you need to connect with. Because if it wasn't for Judas, Jesus would have died of old age. Amen. Your Judas is designed by God to take you to your destiny. Jesus was the only one who was born to die. His ministry was to die. His assignment was to die. And because of that, the Bible says he partnered with this man. Even to the end, the Bible says Judas came and he kissed him. And he said, do you betray the Son of Man with a kiss on the cheek? He embraced him. I preached a message years ago, learning to embrace Judas. Hallelujah. Judas is for your promotion. I said, Judas is for your promotion. Judas is for your promotion. Judas is the one that will help you to go across the line, and you will be able to fight that good fight of faith. The Bible says his disciples say to him, listen, Jesus, we will never leave you. We will never forsake you. We are with you 100%. But when Jesus was arrested, they all taken off. The good fight of faith sometimes means that whenever people who have promised you things, those who have said they're going to stick with you and stand with you, when they leave you, you don't quit. You keep on fighting. You stay in the fight. Somebody stay in the fight. Even if they left you, they hurt you. Let me tell you this. There's so many people out there right now who are so disconnected from God, so disconnected from the Spirit of God because somebody left them. Broken relationship, broken marriage, broke family, disconnected themselves with them. Let me just say this. Encourage yourself in the Lord because there's resurrection power this morning. Pick yourself up. Clean your clothes and get in the fight. I said, get in the fight. Hallelujah. Bruised, but get in the fight. Staggering, but get in the fight. Black eye, but get in the fight. Come on, somebody. I said, get in the fight. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, don't give up. Don't give in. Jesus never gave up. He never gave in. He said to Peter, Peter, before the cock crows thrice, you would have denied me three times. Peter said, I will never deny you. Men will make you promises and they will break them. Only God can make promises and keep them. Don't ever let broken promises cause you to stop fighting. You've been called by God. You've been anointed by God. Don't allow somebody's rejection cause you to stop doing what God's called you to do. Well, I tried to pray for them. They didn't want me to pray for them, so I'm not coming back. No, keep on keeping on. I said, keep on keeping on. Stay in the fight. I said, stay in the fight. I said, stay in the fight. I said, stay in the fight. Hallelujah. Only God can make promises and keep them. His promises, the Bible says, are yea and amen. God keeps his promises. But let me just say this. Everywhere you go, you will be promised things by folk. And folk will always break their promises. They will say one thing and do the other. Peter said, I will never leave you. When the rubber meets the road, I'm ride or die when he comes with him to me and you. I'm sticking with you. But when he was arrested, they all took off. Peter stood there with him. They said, were you not there? Were you not with him? We saw you in the meeting with him. He said, I'm not. You got me mixed up with somebody else. Three times he denied Christ. Then the cock crowed and Jesus stand and looked at him. And the Bible says Peter must have looked at Jesus' swollen face, black eye, and looked at him. And he turned around and he ran. And God is saying part of you staying in the fight of faith is learning to restore even those who have broken promises to you. God is a God of second chance. We have to learn to give people a second chance. That is staying in the fight. Hallelujah. Somebody say it's a good fight. It's not a bad fight. We don't counsel folk, amen. We don't disconnect ourselves from people just because they messed us up. Because they can't keep their word. They didn't stay with us and stick with us. We go to them and we say to them, Peter, do you still love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. He denied him three times and three times he restored him. Sometimes God wants us to learn to go and restore relationships. Some of you may have relatives that hurt you deeply, that wounded you deeply, but they are necessary for your assignment. Sometimes you have to humble yourself, pick up the phone and say, I know you hurt me. I know you wounded me. I know I gave you money and you said you pay me and you never paid me, but I'm still going to build relationship with you because we need to go together. Hallelujah. I'm here encouraging somebody. Amen. I said amen. Are we alive this morning? Yes. Come on, somebody. We have to get to that place where we get encouraged and begin to restore this relationship. People that may have hurt you, wounded you, go and restore those relationships. If they are pertinent for the move of God, if they are necessary for your assignment, go and be restored. Say to them, I am not going to go anywhere until you are walking with me in relationship. I will forgive you for broken promises. forgive them for betrayal, knowing that that betrayal, God works it together for your good. Joseph, when he stood there, dressed like Pharaoh, beautiful garments, gold everywhere. His brothers came to buy food. They didn't even recognize him. They sold him. They're the ones who took his coat of many colors. And the Bible says that they killed a lamb and put blood on it and went to the dad and said, listen, your son has died. He's been killed by a wild animal. But you know what? He understood that God was using him, that all things will work together. At that point in time, it looked like betrayal. But you may not know that God is actually positioning you to be a blessing to the nation. God knows how to not just use good things, but he knows how to use bad things as well. He will use the vehicle of torment, even the vehicle of conflict, the vehicle of rejection, the vehicle of trauma. He will use it to take you and ferry you to your destiny. Hallelujah. So don't waste your pain. Your pain is not going to be wasted. If you stay in the fight, your pain is going to result in gain. Oh, hallelujah. Paul, the Bible tells us that he went to that place, and the Bible says they took his first coat. They took it to his dad, told him the coat of many colors, your son is dead. But when he got into Potiphar's house, Potiphar gave him another coat. He became the head servant in the house, and he was fixing everything. And Potiphar's wife began to watch him. Oh, this guy is handsome. He's good looking. I'm going to get him one day when everybody is around. And so one day everybody was gone, he goes and he begins to say, hey, could you come and clean some things in the room? And he comes in there, and the Bible says that she jumps on him. And he decides, oh no, I will not sin against God. I will not sin against my master. I will not sin against my father. God can see me. I'm in a fight of faith. It's going to be a good fight, even if it costs me. He took off and she left behind his second coat. He ran for his life because he said, I'm going to stay in the fight. No compromise. Sometimes staying in the fight looks like you're taking two steps forward and three steps back. He went from the auction block to a house, and it may not be the best, but at least it's not prison. Now he has a false charge on him, and because of the false charge, he ends up in prison. He prophesies after so many years in jail, prophesies to two people. One is killed. The other one, he is restored. The one who's restored totally forgets about him, but he stays in the fight. When you invest in people and they go places and they leave you behind, stay in the fight. I say stay in the fight. You know what happened after that? The Bible says that he came one day. Pharaoh had a dream, and he could not explain what the dream was. And God gave Joseph the understanding of that dream. And the Bible tells us that when God did that for him, he released him, and he got himself into the palace. And when he got into the palace, the same coat that was on Pharaoh. Pharaoh took that coat and put it on him. If they take the first one, let them take it. There's another one for you. If Potiphar's wife takes your second coat, let them take it. Stay in the fight. Somebody say, stay in the fight. Some of us, we are wounded and hurt because we lost our jobs. Because of our values, or because we took a stand. And now we're in a place where we have lost job. Let me just say this. If they take your coat, let them take it. God has got a better coat for you. Amen. God has got a better job for you, a better position for you. He is allowing you to move from glory to glory. Because every branch that bears fruit, he prunes so that it can go from fruit to more fruit. Pruning process is never easy. But if we stay in the fight, we will survive the pruning process. The pruning process is when we get cutbacks in life. Things leave our lives. But God causes us to that to happen because he wants us to go from fruit to more fruit. Somebody say more fruit. Jesus stayed in the fight. He never gave up. He never gave in. He never threw in the towel. He stayed in the fight. Even when he was rejected and everybody had left him, he stayed in the fight. Finally, the Bible says that he was on the cross and they hang him and they crucified him. I can feel the pain in his arms and in his feet and the blood coming down on his back, and his head had a crown of thorns, but he was still in the fight. And finally, when he was hanging there on the cross, he cried out and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Have you ever been in a situation where you feel like God has turned his back on you? Am I preaching to such super spiritual people? How many of you have ever gone through that? Where you feel like God loves everybody else but me? Come on, is it just me? Even Jesus went through that, and he is the Son of God. He hung him there and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Even when you feel like God is blessing everybody else but you, stay in the fight. Stay in the fight. Stay in the fight. Even when you see others going places and getting breakthroughs and miracles and they're getting promotions, and you're saying, God, this person doesn't even serve you like I serve you. They don't even love you like I love you. Yet they're getting blessed more than me. But stay in the fight. Stay in the fight. And sometimes you being able to stay in the fight means that the ones who have crucified you, who are looking at you, they have hung you on the cross, looking down at them and say, I forgive you. And praying and saying, Father, forgive them. For they know they don't know what they're doing. Stay in the fight. And because if you are going to wear a crown of glory, you may need to first wear a crown of thorns. There is no resurrection if there is no death. And sometimes God will allow you to go through the process even while you're in the fight, where it looks like you have come to the end of everything. But no matter what happens, stay in the fight. It's called the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. The good fight of faith. You may need to forgive those who have crucified you. You may need to let them go. You may need to release them. That means Anastasia Palaszczuk. Come on, somebody, for some of you. That means Daniel Andrews. Come on, somebody. That means Scott Morrison, because I know some are mad at him right now. We may need to forgive him. Amen. Amen. You've crucified me. You've nailed the church on the cross, but we forgive you. Come on, somebody. Don't carry that offense. When they are throwing rocks at you, sometimes you've got to learn to forgive. Even at that time, Stephen was being stoned to death. But even as they were stoning him to death, his eyes was on Jesus. He wasn't looking to see who's throwing the rocks. Who would say that? Who made that comment? Who? No, he just kept his eyes on Jesus. The Bible says that heaven stood. Jesus was standing at the right hand of the Father. Every time we read about Christ, he is seated at the right hand of the Father. But those who learn to stay in the fight, even heaven will stand for them. Amen. Hallelujah. I said, come on, give God praise right now. Pastor, what does it mean? I'm saying that even if it costs you your life, stay in the fight. Weeping may endure for a night. Sometimes serving God feels like you're dying. Stay in the fight. Paul was in the fight and he was staying in the fight. He said, I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to give in. He says, for I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Sometimes the will of God, you embracing the will of God, means you're staying in the fight. Now, before you think the will of God is chocolates and candy, no. Sometimes God may show you that it is my will for you that you drink from this cup. Jesus prayed. Have you ever found yourself in a place where you're praying, God, deliver me from this thing? But then you say, nevertheless, not my will. Let your will be done. Sometimes God will put you in places you don't want to be. He will put you in jobs you don't want to have. He will keep you serving in capacities you don't want to serve. And it may be that every day we have to pray that prayer. Take this cup away from me. But nevertheless, If it is not your will, I'm going to put on my clothes and go to work. I'm going to stay in the fight. And if it means to do it till the day you take me to heaven, so be it. Amen. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, stay in the fight. Am I helping somebody? Yes. Let me just say this. There is a resurrection on the other side. Sometimes staying on the fight causes you to die. Sometimes staying in the fight causes you to feel like something has come to an end in your life. Sometimes staying in the fight may mean that you have lost some things. But let me just say this, weeping may endure for a night. When Jesus was there and he died, the Bible says that he closed his eyes and he gave up his spirit, and his spirit came up and went to hell. And the Bible says he preached to the souls in hell. But on the third day, oh, somebody needs to wake up in this place. I said on the third day. I said on the third day. I said on the third day. There is resurrection. Because if there's a sowing, there's going to be a reaping. Come on, somebody. I said if there's a sowing, those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. So I came to tell somebody, keep on keeping on. Because God is about to turn things around for you. God is about to cause the stone to be rolled away. If you keep on staying in the fight, sooner than later, the crown of glory is going to be released over your life. You will find the things that used to hurt you don't hurt you anymore. Because people who have died cannot be moved by conflict, cannot be moved by criticism, cannot be moved by praise. Because they're, come on somebody. You will find that when you rise from the dead, that everybody that took whatever was yours before is now under your feet. You know, when Joseph received Pharaoh's coat, the one who took the first one, the sons, were now under his feet. Potiphar and his wife probably left Egypt. They said, he's gone into the, we better leave because this guy's going to put us in jail. Whenever God gives you that last, when you stick to it until the crown of glory comes, he will cause everything to turn around. So you are setting up, you are paying a price right now. You are just sowing something right now. But let me just say this, if there's a sowing, there's going to be a reaping. Jesus said, I am a seed. He said, if a seed falls to the ground, it abides alone. But if it dies, it will begin to produce fruit. The reason why sometimes we don't see much fruit in our lives is because we give up fighting before all is said and done. But I came to tell somebody, stay in the fight. Because if you stick with it, 3 days later, God is going to release his resurrection power. He's going to release his resurrection power. He's going to release his resurrection presence. He's going to release his resurrection anointing. That means that God will begin to bring restoration. That means that God will begin to release blessings and increase and anointings over your life. People may say, how is it that you're in this place? You will tell them it is because of God. Hallelujah. When Jesus rose from the dead, he did not need doorknobs to step into rooms. Come on, somebody. That means when you get to that level, God will begin to give you supernatural acceleration. He will give you supernatural increase. People will look at you and say, how is it that you don't look like we remember you? You remember when they stood in front of Joseph? They didn't even recognize him. And they were his brothers. When you come out on the other side, there's going to be such a glory over you that those who knew you then will not recognize you now. I came to prophesy to somebody. I said, if you keep on keeping on, you're going to be able to do the impossible. If you keep on keeping on, heavens are going to be open to you. When you keep on keeping on, God is going to give you victory over death. Because what has died cannot be killed again. When he rose up from the dead, he lives forever and ever and ever and ever. Let me tell you, when you come back out of the dead, because we die with him. The Bible says that we are crucified with him. We are buried with him and we shall rise with him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. That means that if he is seated in heavenly places, we are seated with him in heavenly places, far above principalities and powers and rulers of darkness of this world. When you get to that place, no devil, no demon, no power of darkness will be able to stand before you. God wants us to pay that price. If we can have the musicians up. Shada baba bariando sata. I came to prophesy to somebody in this place. I say this resurrection Sunday. I say this resurrection Sunday. It's resurrection Sunday. Amen. Stay in the fight. Amen. Stay in the fight. And so one of each and every one of us, God is going to allow us to say it is finished. Don't quit until you can say it is finished. Don't stop until you can say it is finished. When you put your hand to the plow, stick with it until it is finished. There's a blessing God is releasing right now. I feel there's an anointing God is pouring out. Let's stand up on our feet if we can. Oh, Father, we bless your name. We bless your name. If you've been, you feel like you've been bruised and battered and punched out by life, you feel like you're messed up, you're not in a good place. Right now, let God just minister to you right now. Even Jesus, as he carried the cross, the Bible says the women ministered to him. They wiped his face. They cleansed him. They ministered to him. When Elijah was discouraged and he sat by the tree ready to die, the Bible says God sent the angels to minister to him. When Jesus was on Gethsemane and the Bible says that his sweat became like blood, the angels appeared and began to minister to him. I felt in my spirit that God wants to send angelic, divine, Holy Ghost ministration in this place right now. He's going to begin to minister to you. Because some of us, we just got one last string before we give up. We are ready to throw in the towel. But Father, I pray this resurrection Sunday morning that your people in the name of Jesus, they're receiving supernatural strength to stay in the fight. That they're not going to give up. They're not going to give in. They're not going to throw in the towel. They're not going to let any situation talk them out of God's best for them. I thank you, Holy Spirit, right now that you're releasing your resurrection power. Your resurrection power is being released right now. I'm going to open the altar in the name of Jesus. If you're saying, I just need a touch from God. I just need the Holy Spirit to touch me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, because I need strength to walk for the next few, for the days ahead, that I need God to give me strength that I will not throw in the fight. Come right now, come to the altar. The resurrection power of Jesus is in this place. Come to the altar, come to Jesus right now, come to him. He said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Sometimes you as a fighter may need rest. Sometimes even in a normal fight, the bell rings and he lets you sit on the side. You get some ministry. He gives you some water before you get back in the fight. Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. If you feel like you need God to just cause life to come upon you, right now come to the altar. You're saying, man of God, I just feel worn out sometimes. I feel worn out. I feel exhausted. I feel like I just don't have any more energy. God wants to release something over your life right now. If we can just have Chris and David and Julie come up here. Come up here. Labrande, just in front of them. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. We're going to minister right now. Resurrection power. Pastor Bill. Come up here in the name of Jesus. Shada baba bari anda da boko sata. Mi brande kesete le brando ko shada daba. Just begin to pray for them. Begin to pray. When you feel that anointing, begin to lay hands on them. Right now, we thank you for resurrection power that you're releasing in this place. Resurrection power. Pastor Pat, if you're available, come. Shada baba bariande kesete lebrando koshata labrande. Lebrande kesete lebranda kashada baba baba sade. Librande kesete. I see Pastor John and Pastor Elizabeth back there. If you're able to come, if any of you is available, come. In Jesus' name, just come and begin to minister to them right now. Because God is releasing resurrection power. I feel like He's causing you to receive rest. There's rest that God is releasing right now. Rest is coming right now in the name of Jesus. 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 Father, we thank you. We thank you. Martin, you want to come and help Kachin? Just come. Just help out if you can. Hope you don't have a bad back. Praise God. You good? Just come. Come and help out in the altar. Father, we thank you. Bernard, want to come and help Kach? Shane? Come and help out. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. Let your presence right now come. The Lord is releasing His grace. There's breakthroughs right now. Breakthroughs right now. Breakthroughs right now. And we thank you for healings. We thank you for miracles. Father, I thank you for breakthrough right now. That where there has been discouragement, there's encouragement that God is releasing. Encouragement that God is releasing. Encouragement that God is releasing. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I thank you. I decree and declare. That. Oh, Shabbababasene. You're going to stay in the fight. You're going to stay in the fight. You're going to stay in the fight. Whatever the Lord gives you. Just sing one. Worship. Father God, I release the presence of God. I release the anointing. In the name of Jesus. I release. Receive it. From the top of your head to the soles of your feet, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father God, I thank you. In the name of Jesus, I release the power of the Holy Ghost. From today, strength is coming. From today, strength is coming. From the day, today, I release right now fire of the Holy Ghost. Receive it, receive it. Take one step towards me. You're stepping into new beginnings. New beginnings, new beginnings, new beginnings, new beginnings. Take one step forward. New beginnings, new beginnings. You're stepping into a place of strength to stay in the fight. There will be no weariness, no tiredness. God is restoring you right now. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that even as He fights, even when it regards family, you will not just fight for you, but you are fighting for family as well. Thank you, Lord, that there will be no weariness or tiredness. Strengthen these hands. Strengthen them. Give them arrows and hearts that will hold these hands up. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, that as you touch Him, touch grace as well. To stay in the fight. In Jesus' mighty name.
In love you came and gave amazing grace.
Oh, Shabbababasade. I release right now in the name of Jesus the grace to stand, to stand, to stand, to stand, to stand, to stand. In Jesus' mighty name, take one step forward. You're stepping into new things in God. Stepping into a fresh anointing, a fresh grace, a fresh power of the Holy Ghost that is coming over you even right now. Your life will never be the same again. Oh, He's releasing His grace. Seated.
Seated on the throne. Jesus.
is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. So worthy is the Lamb.
Oh, hallelujah.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Father, we bless your name. I release right now Resurrection Sunday blessing over this church, over each and every single person. I speak the blessing of the Lord. I decree and declare dry bones coming alive. And Father, I thank you that even as your people get ready to leave this place, we're not leaving you behind. We are going with you. We ask you that your presence will go with us. We ask you to touch those who are watching at home, those who may be watching from around the world. Father, we pray for them. The same blessing that you're releasing here, release there. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God, for the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. I release the blessing of the Lord. I decree and declare journey mercies, protection for those who are traveling. We thank you. As we prayed on Friday, we seal that prayer right now with thanksgiving for safety on the roads for those who are traveling and those who may be going places. In Jesus' mighty and holy name. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore, and surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever. Somebody say amen.